Davao businessman Dennis Uy insists the controversial Malampaya deal was a strictly private transaction in a cyber libel suit filed against ABS-CBN. In the complaint, which was filed in November but was only received by ABS-CBN this week, Uy also said the company did not get his side before publishing the story on the graft complaint he was facing along with Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi. He added he suffered reputational damage when media outlets reported about it. We also disputed allegations that Udena-Chevron deal was an incredible crony agreement, adding he was not given undue advantage by the government. Uy and Cusi's camp earlier said they filed a cyber libel suit against several media outlets because no graft complaint had been lodged at the time of the story's publication back in October 19th. The graft complaint against the two was filed on October 18th. ABS-CBN is the parent firm of this news channel. The Philippine Labor Department has suspended operations at its head office due to the latest wave of COVID infections. Our correspondent, Liza Aquino, now joins us live for more details. Hi, Liza. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi. The services of Department of Labor and Employment in the central office in Intramuros as well as its regional office in the National Capital Region will not be available to the public starting today until January 17. Labor Secretary Silvestre Bello III has suspended work for the said period with the surge of COVID-19 cases, particularly in NCR. From a handful of cases at the start of the year, Bello reported that infected officials and staff of the department numbered 128 as of Thursday night, or about 21% of DOLIS central office personnel of around 600. In a memorandum issued on Thursday, Bello directed all heads of offices, services, and bureaus, including the NCR regional office, to resume work on January 18. Earlier in the week, Bello directed all DOLI offices and attached agencies in the areas with surging number of COVID cases across the country to implement alternative work arrangements, including work from home for their personnel. Skeletal workforce shall be limited to those performing or providing essential services. The said work arrangements will take effect until January 30. Not included in the flexible work arrangements are personnel in the offices of the secretary, undersecretaries, assistant secretaries, as well as the office of the directors. In issuing directive, Bello enjoined all officials and employees to continue observing public health standards and other safety protocols in the workplace to help curb the spread of COVID-19. Back to you, Mimi.
Thank you for that, Liza. Thank you for joining us and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you too.
In other news, the Philippine Central Bank and several business groups believe the Philippines can still hit its growth target for 2022 if the Omicron variant is contained in the first quarter of the year. Warren de Guzman reports.
COVID-19 cases are still surging at a record-breaking pace, but that hasn't fazed the Filipino-Chinese business community nor the Philippine Central Bank. Henry Lim Bonleong, president of the Filipino-Chinese Chambers of Commerce and Industry Incorporated, says as long as the current surge is resolved quickly, growth will remain strong.
Our economic growth that I forecasted now, around 6.5% to 7.5% for this year, still remains now. Of course, the Omicron virus has put a dampening effect on this one, but as I see and I feel the pulse of our members organizations. So I think as long as it doesn't go beyond the first quarter, we can still achieve a respectable 6.5%. But if it goes beyond the first quarter, then maybe you have to amend.
Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno gave the same assessment at the inauguration of the Management Association of the Philippines 2022 board, assuring the Philippine business community that rising lending, adequate bank capital, and easing inflation all point to a steady economic recovery.
We will still hit our projected growth of 7 to 9%. So the variant, as it turned out, is mild and less lethal. And so we're early in the year, right? So we hope that the variant will be gone by maybe middle of February or at the latest March. So that gives us confidence that we will hit our our growth target of 7 to 9% this year and 6 to 7% for the next 2 years.
Jochner says another reason for optimism is the buffer provided by gross international reserves, which hit $108.9 billion as of December, good for over 10 months worth of imports of goods and payments of services, or 8.8 times the Philippines' short-term external debt based on original maturity. On top of this, Jochner notes bank lending has picked up, which is a sign of improved confidence on the part of the lenders as well as the borrowers, with both sides feeling confident the loans won't end up as bad debt even as the pandemic rages on.
As of the week of December 23, 2021, the banking system allocated an average of $244.4 billion loans to micro, small, and medium enterprises. This is a substantial increase from the $8.7 billion in MSME loans reported in April 2020. Banks currently remain cautious, but project rather positive business outlook in the next 2 years.
Newly installed MAP President Alfredo Pascual, however, reiterates his organization's stand. If the current surge forces some form of return to tighter mobility restrictions, the economy will suffer. He says instead, the government should focus on enabling the economy to move beyond pre-pandemic levels of performance.
Why should we return to the old normal? The pandemic has proved to be an excellent mirror for humanity, for all of us, in highlighting the social and economic inequalities and systemic weaknesses that afflict our people. We must address the country's energy security, resolve foreign ownership restrictions in critical industries, and improve the ease of doing business, to name just a few imperatives.
Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.